Find the London scene because I lived in a very small town in Somerset where if you farted, everybody knew. And I think there was me and one other person who were there. And so I came to London to have some fun.
I used to ride a motorbike in those days, and I got to the venue, and I just was too nerve-wracked to go in. And I went round the block and round the block. I don't know how many times I went round the block. And each time I'd say to myself, pull yourself together, you know, come on, you know, just walk up those stairs, get a ticket and go on.
And I went down and I was really disappointed because it was so tiny, but there were all these women and I kept looking at them all thinking, yes, they definitely all are.
Of course, I was always aware that a gay scene existed. I knew it was somewhere. I'd heard about it, but I couldn't find my way into it. Of course, in those days, there was no gay switchboard, there was no newspapers, no Capital Gay. You had to battle it out yourself and meet people as best you can.
Well, in those days, we hadn't got any chocolates or anything at all. Nothing. We were during the war, and this man who took me down used to give me cigarettes because I loved it. In those days, you know, flying bombs were going all over the place, but it didn't matter.
Of course, to a lot of people, the blackout made London into one vast double bed. But that wore off after a bit, and people behaved a bit less wildly. But I still went to the cafes, which, of course, had once had windows onto the street. Now I'm certainly painted out or covered over with paper. Curtains that you had to go through and make sure they were shut behind you before you could get into the cafes. It meant, of course, that the cafes and the bars were boiling hot and full of smoke. You could hardly see at all because nothing ever got outside.
Hello, I'm Betty Bourne from the Blue Lips, and I'll be taking you on a quick pink plaque tour of Soho, whisking you around a few of the places where we used to drink and dance and fall in love. Mess about, you know, just like everybody else does.
Now, this behind me was Ward's Irish Bar, and they had a lot of booths in there, and each of the booths was named after one of the counties of Ireland. Very crowded, very smoky. And part of this place now, well, it's changed now, of course, but we're in the Trocadero. God help us. And I'll put the plaque there and escape as quickly as I can.
Sailors' bars, I mean, it was the Wards.
Oh, the sailors' bars, it was Wards in Piccadilly. I mean, really, if you'd like to use the word gorgeous sailors, gorgeous bits of butch. If you took home, you'd lock the family silver up as a general rule. Have you got any sense?
Remove the number from the telephone.
And remove the number from the telephone. And another thing, they'll always put their cap in the car, preferably in the boot, you know, because no sailor would go back without his cap.
If you've gone in there for a drink, and said, gosh, he looks terribly attractive. I rather fancy you couldn't sort of whisk him off to the Ritz or anything like that. A, the Ritz or the Savoy or whatever you like to call it wouldn't allow him in because he was considered. No, he was absolutely, completely immaculate. You just did.
Fogger's up, Ducky. Your mother's a stretcher case.
It's because mother takes her gin on a drip feed.
What was I like in that club?
Like Mae West, only ballroom with bigger tits. How far are we to go?
A mere powder compact's throw from here, Heartface. And a boner, little lassie, stocked with gin. Faster, driver!
Take it easy, will you? We don't want any trouble with Betty Bracelets.
Keep your eye on, we're immune. We are girls in uniform. Wren's on shore leave, starring Deanna Durbin and Gracie Fields.
Shut your mouth, will you?
I should be in Hollywood. Carmen Miranda, eat your hat out.
Hiyas!
We'll take two of your finest tickets to Camberwell, conductor. And, do give my best to the little woman in the knickers.
And whose little boy are you, then? Is he with you? God help us.
Wait a minute, I know you. You're Boris Karloff's big sister, and I claim my £5. Tell me, officer, my friend and I was just one...
Shut up, will you?
Do you think she's on the team?
Who?
The Omi and the Bijou Capella.
You don't fancy him, do you?
Well, I'm not sure. Bona brandy on it. Dolly Drag, too.
Shut your screech, he's coming back.
Tell me, officer. My friend and I was just wondering.
Yes?
What time do you get off?
I beg your pardon?
Do you work in shifts?
I generally find them more comfortable.
There was, of course, Polari, the so-called private language, with odd words which some people spoke, but neither of us certainly spoke it. We might use the odd word like troll and...
Camp.
Oh, camp, yes, it has. But they were just words put into our language, and incidentally, they were secret passwords. You could identify with other gay people. If you thought they might be, you would drop a word in, like camping about or something like that. Or I'm going camping, but I'm taking my tent.
My friend and I picked up this language quite easily. It was marvellous because we could sit on a tube train or somewhere or on a bus and talk about the person opposite using this Polari, which nobody could understand except theatrical people. And because so many gay people were theatrical, it became a sort of gay language.
It's such a mixture. There's a little bit of backslang in it. For instance, I mean, ecaf is face backwards. There's a little bit of Latin in it. There's a little bit of Romany Gypsy. There's a little bit of Italian. I mean, if I were to say, what a lovely hat that girl's got on, I'd say, what a Bona Capello on the Palou.
Thank you.
food was rationed then, and I went into Compton Street one Saturday evening, and there was Quinton sitting at a table. So I sat down, and across from us was a Trinidadian group of boys reading the Rubaiyat of Omar Khayyam, and Quinton and myself, we chatted there.
It was called The Black Cat, and it was at the Wardour Street end of Compton Street. On the northern side, it then became one of Mr. Parmigiani's shops, and finally disappeared altogether, as far as I know. It was there for several years. It was a very small cafe with torn linoleum on the floor and marble tops and tables. And as far as I remember, it only served... I don't know whether it even served sandwiches, coffee, buns, bits of dried up cake, tea, probably a few soft drinks, of which there were very few in those days.
I met Bernard in a pub called the Fitzroy in the West End, quite a famous pub, and I went into the Fitzroy really to be with my own kind, nothing more. And suddenly Bernard popped up and offered me a drink. Well, actually, he started off by saying, it's crowded in here, isn't it?
So I must staunchly deny that. I'm incapable of such an inane remark in a crowded club as it's crowded in here, but do go on, miss.
Right, and then he offered me a drink and I rejected it rather rudely because I had no wish to have anything to do with this young man who was addressing me. But he persisted and...
Only in buying him a drink.
Yes, a half only.
So we're at the Fitzroy in Fitzrovia, where in the 50s there was quite a lot of activity around here. And in those days, homosexuality was quite illegal. And in fact, the pub was raided quite a few times.
You know, if you were... what you were called today over the top, you know, I mean, is where you wouldn't consider yourself. You'd probably have a height of powder too much on one cheek or something, which was obvious to other people, but might not be. You might have missed it as you got ready to go out. And, you know, the barman there, so-called butch barman, would say, sorry, dear, out. You know, of course, you couldn't make a fuss. People watched you, so, you know, wink their eye at you or something like that. You just had to leave, you know, there's no question of staying there. But you go elsewhere, because that's not your pub or club.
Hello. This is number two on our mini tour, and this is the Marquess of Cranberry here, the Duke of York's up there, and I'm just going to pop over to the Wheatsheaf. These are all very queer places, full of lots of queers, all sexes. See you over there.
I mean, this was just after the war, so a lot of people that had just come out of the forces, plus a lot of theatrical people in the West End, used to go to these places, and I met quite a what we used to call a camp crowd, because camp is a word we used all the time. We didn't use queer and we didn't use gay.
I've changed my mind. I'm not going in here. It's where they threw my friend Quentin Crisp out of. So I think I'll just pop down to the Black Horse.
The pubs I went to there, one was in Rathbone Place and was called the Wheatsheaf, but in the end I even got turned out of that, and everybody protested and they rushed up to the proprietor and said, how can you do this? And the proprietor, of course, said, I don't give a damn what he does or what he is. The police come to this pub and they say, you run a funny sort of place. And when the owner says, what, how funny, how, he says, that funny.
Mm-hmm.
when the coronation was taking place, they thought they would clean up London. Prior to that, London was pretty swinging, and the drag shows were banished, and places that were gay people went to were sort of cleaned up and frightened off, really.
But what used to happen then is, if the pub was raided, those people who were in there, you know, they just took your names and addresses, and then, you know, it was a form of harassment those days. And the pub would go quiet for a week to a month, and everybody start drifting back in again.
And whenever there were raids, I'd used to just usually grab the nearest man that happened to be sitting at the bar and say I'd come in with him. And if ever I was asked if I bought a drink, I'd always say no, of course I haven't, he bought me one.
There was always raiding the clubs and taking your names and address, which it frightened some people. And I can remember at the time that if you went out in a frock, if the police, if they saw you in the car, they would stop you and they would ask you to get out the car, which you didn't do, because as soon as you got out the car, then they would pinch you for soliciting.
It was because I was supposed I wasn't effeminate, put it that way. I wasn't camping, as you say. Though I couldn't care a fish's tit, matey, one way or another. It doesn't worry me in the slightest. But you didn't. One led a double life. I mean, my father and mother, they're both dead, so it doesn't matter in the slightest. But I would never let them down. I led a double life. But you could do it, as long as you were discreet.
You see, your mere manner would get you into jail. If you were arrested, nobody had to prove anything. They said they saw you walking up and down the street between the hours of this and that. And the magistrate would say, have you anything to say for yourself? And the moment the victim said, well, it was like this, Your Honor. 6 months.
In those days, men wore sort of dark coloured suits and white shirts. They didn't wear floral pastel shirts or pink shirts or anything because that was sort of frowned upon. So, the women that wanted to be very heavy dykes did completely ape male sort of dress. And they usually were always attracted to very feminine women, so the women looked ultra, ultra feminine usually. I wore suits and collar and tie. I didn't like the ties too much. I used to rub my neck. I didn't like them when I was in the army, actually, so that was nothing new to me. Some of the older people were actually dressed in smoking jackets and were smoking pipes and things like that. I couldn't believe it all, really. And there I was in my little suit that I'd got from a catalogue, out of Littlewood's catalogue, and I thought I was looking quite butch at the time. Like, this was amazing to me.
Oh, there were lots of other women around in suits in those days. Some of them I used to envy because they were quite tall and they looked really good. But I didn't look too bad, as long as I was done up in a suit. And in the days of what we call brothel creepers, you got a high heel, although it was a man's shoe. And then I used to even put supports inside my shoes to make myself look taller. Always had a thing about my height, so I prefer people lying down.
See that butch number with the big martini on her? She said I had the look of a Lena Horne.
Lena Horne? You? Kenneth Horne, more like.
Jealous.
Me? Jealous? Honestly, one compliment from a Polony going as Cliff Richards and you go all femmy.
She did not look like Cliff Richards. She was much butcher.
Anyway, thought she was married to that piece in the cashmere and crimpoline.
What, George? You must be joking. It makes Liberace look like a lumberjack. Anyhow, she was so busy smooching with that one in the skin-tight Lou Coddy suit, I didn't get a look in.
No, neither did I tonight. Mind you, some nights I like just looking. All those lovely lollies.
Tall ones, short ones.
Some as big as your hat.
Most lesbians, young lesbians, actually wanted to look like Cliff Richards because he had the perfect hair. And in fact, to such an extent, I think a lot of us used to fantasize that he was really a lesbian, just pretending to be a man. And there used to be one character that did go to one of the clubs of Fiesta, and she really looked like Cliff Richards. And I remember I used to hate her a lot because the girl I was with used to like her a lot.
What made the Gateways different to me anyway, coming from the East End and sort of spending my social time in the West End, were these sort of more upmarket type people than I was used to fraternising with. There was lady doctors and lawyers and bank managers and company directors.
I give up that goddess if I were a queen. It's not a palace, it's my everything. There's a queen waiting there with a silvery hair in a shanty, an old shanty town.
The West End and the East End, there's a difference, a community difference anyway. And the East End queens were much more based within their own community, so it was their territory. Whereas we West End queens, we were just sort of like gypsies moving from place to place, you see.
I always just feel very sorry for the West End queens, simply because they weren't allowed to really be themselves. They worked in their various offices and bits with their collars and ties on, and they were George by day, you know, and Fishy Francis by night sort of carry on.
For all you posh queens, here I am in Archer Street.
This is the Rockingham, where I came when I was a very young boy. I was having an affair with a rather grand public school boy, and he brought me here one night, and I was very nervous, you know. I was, you know, from Hackney. I didn't know anything from anything. So we went inside, and on the right there was the club, and I got in there. And everybody was frightfully like that, the gins and tonics, you know, and all that sort of stuff. And I was quite frightened, really. And so I just kept my mouth shut. As I said, I was from the East End, and all these posh people there clinking their glass. It was frightening too. Anyway, we're going to put up this lovely pink plaque here on the wall, just so that people know that we were here. This was our place, one of our places, you know. So there we go, lovely pink plaque. We press hard and hope it doesn't fall off. There we are, you know. It's all frightfully discreet, you know.
Put your coat down, then you went down in the basement. There was a pianist in the corner who used to play soft music, Cole Porter, or Ivan Novello, Neil Card. And it was frightfully, frightfully, frightfully. It was, I mean, I won't say she, but it was smart. It was nothing went wrong. I mean, everyone talked. You never took your affair down there at all. Because it wasn't allowed. But the thing is, in those days, you had a lot of fun, but there wasn't any scandal. I say scandal. Of course, there was the odd one or two that got caught. But you had fun.
When we used to go out on Saturday evening, we always dressed up, you know. Well, we'd got shushed up, you know, and we'd look rather nice, you know, and our hair done was quite nice. And so, you know, those nights, on a Saturday night, we always dressed up. Sunday night, you would never be seen dead in clothes what you wore on a Saturday night. You went actually casual out, so that it was a relaxing period. Sunday was the time to say goodbye to people and say hello to your friends again.
Day will break and I'll awake and I will start to bake a sugar cake for you to take for all the way.
Ah, there we are. Now, this place here was called the A&B. It meant Arts and Battle Dress. I don't know quite why it was called Arts and Battle Dress, but I remember coming here when I was about 16. I was working at the Garrick Theatre as the second day electrician, and I used to come here and mix with the Brown Gabardine crowd. It was basically men, you know, and gin and tonics, and kind of strange, really, but quite nice. I used to like it. And there I would come and I'd put the pink black up there, like that. Hope it stays. There you are. I'd go upstairs and I'd look charming.
That period, you're coming on to when the Montague guitars were going on, you see, and everyone seemed to go back into the woodwork. You didn't see very many people about at all. The people you knew, and everyone seemed to sort of disappear.
Because in those days, it was a criminal act. It didn't matter whether you were 60, 70, 80, 90, 100, if you were having sex, it was still illegal.
Then the Wolfenden report recommended a change of the law. Homosexuality was decriminalised in certain cases, and that had an immense difference to the world. We could have a paper like Gay News and things like that happen. So it really was the beginning of a better life for lesbians and gay men.
Ford are unveiling something different. Something that's been exhaustively tested over the last 2 years. We're not talking about a new Ford. We're talking about a new way for you to get one. It's not leasing, it's not buying, and it's not like ordinary HP. It's called Options from Ford. For your prospectus, call free on 0800 111 222.
Get set, go! Get a $2.99 Whopper meal deal at Burger King. Want the famous flame-grilled Whopper? You got it. Regular fries, regular Coca-Cola. You want a Burger King Whopper meal deal for only $2.99?
You got it.
Want a free Olympic badge with your Whopper meal? Collect all you can before we run out.
As they say at BK, you got it.
On the subject of color, I'm with Henry Ford. Okay?
Totally roasting, dude! I'll get the beakers and caps, you get the roof off.
That's 12 Esso Tiger tokens for each cap and 10 for each beaker.
Freebie-tishious, dudette! I got the stuff, man! And I got the roof! Excellent!
Collect Esso Tiger tokens for free Tiger caps and beakers from the Esso collection.
Just when I need someone to love me, just when I think the world's too cold, there you are, right there beside me. There you are in my heart, standing by me once again. There
Sheba,
you are.
To say I love you.
Only a special person can wear this jacket. It only fits people who have a special spirit of determination. People who help families buy or sell a house every minute of every day. People who are the world's number one real estate sales organization. Now you know why the jacket is colored gold. Century 21. Just tell us what you want. It's as good as done.
Why do mums always kiss you in front of your mates? Why does 30 minutes homework take 3 hours? Why do girls always fancy my mates? And why do Skittles taste so fruity?
'Cause there's real fruit juice in them.
Thank you.
Thames Ford dealers have got together to bring you great K-Reg deals like this Escort LX for just £9,299 on the road. Or for just £8,499 on the road, this special edition Escort Fanfare with sunroof, radio cassette, metallic paint, rear wash wipe and alarm. Both available on finance of 7.4% APR. So visit your Thames Ford dealer for amazing deals on any Ford. All available on the new options plan.